good morning. Welcome to another week of Facebook Live. My name is TJ Daugherty, and I have the privilege of serving as a senior pastor of Central Baptist Church in Paris, Kentucky. Hopefully, many of you are tuning in who are church members, but I also know there are many of you who aren't. And so we want to welcome you. And let me just first say just how thankful I am for the technology to be able to do this and for the small number of folks in this room who have safely gathered so that we can make this possible. And so just please bear with us. We're continuing to figure this out week in and week out. We've got improvements coming, and your feedback has been so encouraging and so helpful for us. But I'm just so thankful that we have the opportunity, even in the midst of this craziness and not being able to physically gather together, I'm so thankful that we have the technology to be able to use the internet and Facebook Live to still hold our Sunday morning services. With that, let me also just kind of give you an update on where things stand as a church this week. Many of you already know we have canceled and closed the doors through the remainder of the month of March. And so that means no Sunday night activities, no Wednesday activities, nothing throughout the week. So next Sunday, at a bare minimum, we will also live stream our Sunday morning services. But beyond that, the doors are closed. And let me just reiterate how painful that is. That's not what anybody here wants. It's not what anybody there wants. We want to gather together. The church longs to gather together. The whole point of Sunday morning gathering for worship is because the church has been called out to come together in corporate worship. And so that hurts me. It hurts all of us. But we sense and we believe that wisdom dictates that we must do that to protect our church members and also to just perform our civil duty at this time. And so just wanted you to know that that hurts. We don't want to, but the doors unfortunately are going to remain closed through the month of March. Now, beyond the month of March, we know this could prolong. This could extend further. So we will give you updates for things beyond that. Just be ready. We don't know what's going to happen. Things can change, and they change rapidly. But just know that things, as things change and as we make decisions, we will pass that information along to you. And on that note, perhaps you're watching on Facebook Live today and you haven't gotten any emails. You haven't gotten any text messages from the church because you're not signed up on a list. And if you want that, please, we want to be able to communicate to you. So call our church office, reach out to someone this week, and we'll get you included in those email and text chains. And if you are one of those who are receiving all this information, please do your best to pass it along to others because it's so vital that we stay connected during this season when we can't get together regularly. So this morning, much like last week, I'm going to introduce or I'm going to begin our time with a word of prayer. And when I'm done praying, we're going to sing. And I know we're going to sing together. It's going to be different. It's not going to be normal, but we're going to sing together. And so let me encourage you in your homes to continue to sing. Sing out loud. Parents, your kids need to see you sing. You need to sing. Let's sing together. And once we're done singing, we're going to hear from the word of the Lord. And then we're gonna close in a time of prayer and a song of invitation. So just prepare your hearts now. All the stuff going on in your home, just turn it all off and let's just focus for just a few moments so that we might hear from God this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we are so thankful this morning to gather in your house, both here physically with a few of us here, but also those who are virtually joining us. God, we're so thankful for the technology. This unprecedented time, all these things that are new to us and new to this world, God, we know that you still sit on your throne, and we are so thankful for that this morning. God, I pray right now that you would prepare our hearts, that you would remove distractions, and that we might worship you through the singing of the word and through the verbal proclamation of the word. God, we pray just that you would be exalted in all these things, that you would receive the glory that is due unto you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us lay aside those things which hinder us and let us worship for the joy of the Lord. Sing with us. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down.
yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen. Pressed but not crushed, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I am blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, then His joy's gonna be my strength. Though the sorrow may last for the night, the joy comes in the morning. I'm trading my sorrows, I'm trading my shame, I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord.
Chosen to come and live among us. He loves us that much, and He promised that He will never leave us, nor will He forsake us. He will hold us fast whatever comes along.
When I feel my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter
God, we give you praise, and so much thanks is due your name, glory and honor. You and you alone are worthy. Thank you for calling us to be your children, claiming us as your own, and holding us forever and ever safely in your arms. We give you thanks and praise in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you for that time of singing. And listen, I hope that that doesn't feel like it does on a normal Sunday morning. I hope that doesn't feel normal, because it's not normal to have to broadcast on Facebook Live. It's not normal to not gather together. And so although this is good, it's still not what we desire. And I hope that there's still some longing. There's a part of you that longs to look around the room and see the saints of God worshiping together. And so though this is not really a substitute, it's just going to have to do until we can gather together. But I pray that in the meantime, that we would make the most of the situation that we have. And I'm thankful that we're able to do that together. If you have a copy of God's Word, I want to invite you to turn with me to the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 12. Gospel of Luke chapter 12, and we're going to be in verses 22 to 31. You know, last week I began my tenure as your senior pastor by preaching a sermon from 2 Timothy chapter 4. And my plan, I'd planned all of this out. I'd thought through it. I'd prayed through it. I'd spent much time and devoted much energy to planning out these introductory sermons. And my plan was to build on what we discussed last week when Paul tells Timothy to preach the word. And so my goal, my purpose was to take that sermon and then develop it with a couple of sermons to follow, in which I would discuss the importance of expository preaching in the gathering of worship. And that was the plan. But then the coronavirus happened, right? And so things have shifted. And so what I've done this morning is, even though I wanted to continue, that was my desire, I knew that most likely I needed to preach a text that might provide some comfort and reassurance for us, because these are unsettling times. And so I think, myself included, that we need to hear those words from God this morning. And so, Lord willing, this week I'm going to preach a sermon from Luke chapter 12, talking about the need not to worry, to not be anxious. And then next week, Lord willing, I will continue to develop this a little bit, and I will discuss from Romans chapter 13 our relationship as a church with the government and the government's mandates and how we might respond to things like that. So, well, I'm putting a hold on kind of where I was going to respond to these things, and I'm thankful and I'm hopeful that these texts and these sermons will be helpful to us during this time. So this morning, as we look at the Gospel of Luke, we're going to consider Jesus' teaching in chapter 12. But leading up to this point, Luke is telling the story of Jesus' life and ministry. And in this section of the Gospel, Luke is taking Jesus to Jerusalem. Jesus is going to Jerusalem. He is going to be sacrificed on the cross. He is going to atone for the sin of his people. He is going to be the lamb that is slain. That is the purpose of Luke's gospel, to take us to the cross, because that's where Jesus is going. And along the way, Jesus is teaching. He's giving instruction. He's preaching sermons. He's spending time with people, both smaller groups that he's called to be his disciples, and then larger groups of crowds. And so Luke is recording many of these teachings that Jesus has along the way as these crowds gather around him. And one day, as Jesus is teaching, someone interrupts him. And he tells Jesus, this is in Luke chapter 12, verse 13. It says, someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." And so Jesus then uses that opportunity to teach about covetousness and greed. And he responds with the parable of the rich fool. Let's keep reading, looking at verse 14. Jesus said to him, "Man, who made you a judge or arbiter over you? Who made me a judge or arbiter over you?" And he said to them, "Take care and be on your guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." And he told them a parable, saying, "The land of a rich man produced plentifully, and he thought to himself, 'What shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops.' And he said, 'I will do this. I will tear down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him, 'Fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God.'" So in this parable, Jesus teaches about the foolishness of storing up treasures on earth, of being greedy, of accumulating things, of filling the storehouses and the barns with all of your stuff. And he highlights the foolishness of this by saying that at any point, your soul may be required of you. Your time may be up, and you will have accumulated all of these things here on the earth, and in an instant, they're gone. He says it's foolish. And immediately following this teaching, we find our text this morning, beginning in verse 22. Now, as we read this, I want you to think through the way the passage is laid out. The text breaks down in kind of four sections. The first two verses, Jesus gives a command. And then the three verses that follow that, he gives an illustration. He gives an argument by way of an illustration. And then he's going to do the same thing in the two verses after that. And then he's going to come back to his command. So I want you to see there's a parallelism here. There's a command, a couple of arguments via examples, and then a follow-up with the command at the end. So keep that in mind as we read, and it'll make it easier to follow as we unpack the text. Let's read from the word of the Lord, beginning in verse 22. And Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? If then you are not able to do as small a thing as that, why are you anxious about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothed the grass, which is alive in the field today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? And do not seek what you are to eat and what you are to drink, nor be worried. For all the nations of the world seek after these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, seek his kingdom, and these things will be added to you." Now, we need to notice something right away here. Right on the heels of his teaching with the crowds. Remember, Jesus is going to Jerusalem. He's on the road, and there's a crowd gathered around him, and someone interrupts his teaching. So he's got the crowds following him. But in the midst of this teaching, Jesus then turns to his disciples. Notice that in verse 22, he said to his disciples. So he has narrowed his teaching down to those who are closest to him. This teaching is not for the masses. This is for his own. This is for the people who follow him. This is for those who believe. And this is going to be important as we unpack the text together this morning. And look at what he says. I'm just going to walk through this passage together. Look at what he says in verse 22. Therefore. Now, immediately when you see that word, that should trigger something for us. When we see that word, therefore, immediately we should recognize that what he is about to say is intimately connected with what he has just said. That's why I read the context, the passage before, because based on the parable of the rich fool, Jesus is now going to give this teaching. Therefore, he issues the command, do not be anxious about your life. Do not be anxious. Do not worry. This command, this is a command, it's not a suggestion, it's a command, it's an imperative. This command is in the present tense. Literally, do not be worrying. This is an ongoing command to not worry. In that sense, this is timeless. The absence of worry should characterize the life of believers at all times. Continue in verse 22. Do not be anxious. Do not worry about your life, about what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on. Now, why does Jesus say this? Seems a little bizarre to think about. Why would he use those words? Why would he say that thing? Well, remember what he has just said. He has just told the parable of the rich fool, and he says, do not store up treasures here. Instead, put all your treasures in heaven. Be rich, not towards yourself, but towards God. And so there might be an inclination. The disciples hear him say that, and he says, and they say to themselves, hang on a second. Like, that's all well and good, but I got to have something, right? Like, I got to be able to eat. I got to have clothes to wear. If I put all my riches, if I put all my treasures in heaven, if that's my entire focus, then how in the world am I going to sustain my life here and now? How will I survive? I've got to have food. I should probably have a little money saved up so that I can make sure I've got an extra set of sandals when these wear out. Like, I've got to be able to think about these things. Let's not kid ourselves here. But Jesus anticipates this question, and he says, do not worry about these things. In fact, do not be worrying ever. Don't ever be worrying. Why? Verse 23, because life is more than food and the body is more than clothing. What's Jesus saying here? He says, there's more to life than food and clothing. These are just means to an end. And the end is to glorify God. You were not created so that you could eat. You eat so you can do what you were created to do, and that is to worship. Don't focus on the means, Jesus says. Don't focus on these things. Focus on the end. Focus on worshiping and glorifying God. That's what life is about, for that's why you were created. And so then Jesus is going to go, there's his command. This is the introduction to what he is communicating. And then he's going to give some arguments. He's going to make his case. Beginning in verse 24, he starts, he says, consider the ravens. Consider the ravens. They don't sow or reap. God hasn't given the ravens the ability to farm and to harvest and to cultivate and to work for food. He's given that to man, but he hasn't even given that to ravens. They don't have that luxury. They have neither storehouse nor barn, nor pantry nor freezer. They have no way to save up food. They have no way to provide for themselves. They have no way to assure their next meal. And yet, Jesus says, God feeds them. Psalm 145 tells us that all the animals look to God to give them their food in due season. And Job 38:41 specifically tells us that God provides food for the raven. God feeds them. He provides for them. And that's really important because keep going in verse 24. How much more valuable are you than mere birds? Jesus here is arguing from the lesser to the greater. God loves the birds because God loves his creation. But God loves you much, much more than he loves the birds. You alone were created in the image of God. You alone are designed with the imprint of the Creator. You are the crown jewel of his creation, the most valuable being in the world. Ravens are great, but they're not nearly as valuable or as important as you are, and yet God feeds them. God still provides for them. You don't think he's going to provide for you too? That's his argument. Now listen, this does not mean that you don't need to do anything. Okay, that's not what this means. God feeds the ravens, but listen, the ravens don't just kick back, lay on a branch, open their mouths, and wait for the food to fall in. They still go and they do what they need to do to eat. Okay, but they're not worried about whether the supermarket's going to have enough food for them tomorrow morning. They're not sitting around fretting over what's going to happen tomorrow. God's going to provide for them. And the same is true for us. This is not a license to not work. This is not a license to sit around and to do nothing. The text doesn't allow for that. Okay? That's not what this is teaching. What it does say is that God is in control, that God loves his creation, and that he will provide. On top of that, Jesus continues in verse 25, which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? Now, some translations might say, maybe yours this morning says something about who can add a cubit to his height. The words there are interchangeable in the original language. There's been some discussion and debate through the years about which translation is most accurate. But the reality is, most people are not worrying about how to add a little height to their stature. Right, most people would be more inclined to worry about their span of life. They're worried about prolonging life or avoiding death. And so contextually, most likely this is a euphemism which says that if somebody is worrying, they're not able to even prolong their life. There's nothing that you can do to prolong your life. And so he says, you shouldn't worry. Do not be anxious. And why would you even want to be? Can you actually change anything? Do you really think that you're in control? Do you think that you can prolong your life? That's his argument. The rich fool didn't have any say. He didn't have any control, and his life was demanded of him in a second. Your days, just like my days, have been numbered. That's already been determined because God is in charge of that, not you. And worrying about these things won't help you. Worrying, Jesus says, is worthless. As someone has rightly pointed out, worry does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow. It merely empties today of its strength. And in fact, we know that worrying actually has an adverse effect on health and the quality of time that you do have. And so worrying doesn't add anything to you. It only takes away. And so in verse 26, Jesus continues. He says, if then you are not able to do as small a thing as that, if you can't even add a single hour to your life, what makes you think that worrying is worth anything? You can't control anything else. You can't even add a single hour to your span of life. So don't worry about everything else. Why are you so concerned when you have no control, but God does? Continue in the text. Jesus is then going to offer a parallel argument in the next two verses. He says, or consider the lilies, the flowers, how they grow. They don't work. They don't toil or spin. They don't worry about how they appear or they scramble to figure out how to clothe themselves. Even Solomon, who had the most ornate and decadent appearance of perhaps anyone in recorded human history, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed or adorned like one of these flowers of the field. Because man-made beauty can't match the beauty that comes directly from the hand of God. And again, Jesus argues from the lesser to the greater. He says, and if God so clothes the grass, which is here today and so quickly gone tomorrow, how much more will he clothe you? Like the birds, God loves the plants because God loves his creation, but he loves you. Listen, he loves you much, much more than he loves the plants because you alone are created in the image of God. You alone bear the imprint of the Creator. You alone are the crown jewel of his creation. And so you are the most valuable being in the world. Plants are valuable. God loves his plants. Plants are good, but they're not human beings. They're not people. And God loves the plants, but he loves his people more. And yet God provides for the plants. You think he's not going to provide for you too? You know, dried grass was actually used in the first century to fuel clay ovens for cooking. And so you would see this grass would have a very short life because what would happen is they would take the grass and they would drain them so that they could dry them out, and then they would use them in an oven so that they could be cooked with as fuel. And Jesus says, Even though there's such a short lifespan on that grass, God still adorns them. You don't think he's going to clothe you as well? And before we move on, there are a couple of other observations that we need to make here. Notice in these two arguments that Jesus has emphasized God's role in providentially caring for his creation. You know, when times are normal, we don't have all this craziness going on. When times are normal and you go to work during the day, or students, you go to school during the day, and then you come home after working and you pick up food, or you come home and you cook, and maybe you watch a show on TV, you do some laundry, some chores, maybe you read a book, and you go about your day and you're focusing on your little world, just making sure everything's where it's supposed to be, all the bills are paid, everybody's in the right place, nobody's hurt. As long as your world is in good shape, you have things under control, that's kind of your focus. Meanwhile, while you're doing all of that in your everyday life, God is holding the universe together. God is in control of everything, and all that he has created, he's caring for it. He's caring for the entire created order. The birds of the air, the fish of the sea, they all continue to function outside of your watch. The intricate ecosystems of the earth continue to exist by the direct hand of God. And not only do they continue, but the beauty of God's creation surrounds us in its midst. In his creation, God did not have to provide beauty. He didn't have to create colors or tastes or beautiful sounds or smells, but he did. And his creation all around us demonstrates the beauty and the goodness and the order and the intentional design and the creativity and the grace of the all-powerful God. But how easy it is to forget, because worry blinds us to these things. Worry makes us miss it. Worry takes our eyes off of the glory and the splendor and the majesty of God, and it puts it on ourselves. We begin to worry about us. We're concerned about what we're going to eat, about what we're going to wear, about how long we're going to live. We worry about what's going to happen with the stock market and with small businesses and with the economy. We worry about the next move our government may or may not make, or how long there's going to be a travel ban and whether or not it might affect our summer vacation. We worry about these things. And when we do, we miss the beauty of God's creation. We miss the beauty of his providence, and we miss the beauty of God himself. So at the end of Jesus' arguments here, so he introduces the command, then he gives his arguments, and at the end of these two arguments, he rebukes his disciples, and he says, "Oh, you of little faith." Now these words, they indicate that the disciples had shown anxiety. They had shown signs of worry. This is not a hypothetical. He's actually accusing them. He says, "Oh, you of little faith." And I'll admit, it's easy when we read those words, it's very easy to disconnect ourselves from the story and to say, that was the disciples, right? Like, I'm not in that boat. Of course, I recognize these things. Of course, I'm paying attention to all that. But the temptation for us to worry is real. And if we're honest with ourselves, we know that we're much closer to where the disciples are than we'd care to admit. It's foolish of us if we ignore that. And so I want to ask this question. Why is the temptation to worry so strong? Why are we so prone to worry? Well, the reality is, if you boil it all down, worry stems from one of two things: either a lack of knowledge or a lack of belief. Take lack of knowledge. Perhaps you don't know that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Perhaps you don't know that God is the all-powerful, sovereign provider and caregiver of his creation. Perhaps you're unaware of how much God loves his creation, because perhaps you don't know the story of the gospel. See, the gospel takes us all the way back to the Garden of Eden, where God places Adam and Eve in the garden, and he gives Adam a commission. He tells Adam to take the image of God, to be fruitful and to multiply, to take his image so that all of creation might worship in unison. But we know that Adam failed in this regard. And instead of bringing worship and life, Adam brings sin and death. And so all of his offspring then have been tainted with a nature that came into the world through that sin. It's a sin nature. That's partly why worry comes so naturally to us, because our sin nature causes us to look at ourselves rather than God. And so in our sin, Man was separated from God. Adam was cast out of the garden. He could no longer have intimate fellowship with God because sinful man cannot associate and have intimate relationship with holy God. But God loved man. God loved his creation, and he loved the world so much that he sent his only son. And so his son Jesus came, the second Adam, came to do what the first Adam failed to do. Jesus lived the perfect sinless life. He fulfilled the law of God, and he brought perfection and worship into this creation. And he lived that perfect and sinless life, and though he didn't deserve it, Jesus went to the cross to die a death that we all deserve to die because of that sin. And he did it in our place. And so if we repent and we believe and we place our faith and trust in him, we are promised that we will be born again and we will now have access to God. So maybe you didn't know that. And if you didn't know that, you wouldn't know about how much God loves and how much he loves his creation. And if you didn't know that, you would probably be pretty prone to worry. You wouldn't have any assurance about who's in control or where your next meal might come from. You wouldn't have any hope. You wouldn't have any stability. But see, the disciples, they knew that. They knew God. And we, those of us in Christ, we know that too. So that's not where our worry comes from. Our worry doesn't come from lack of knowledge. Our worry, instead, like the disciples, it comes from a lack of belief. And Jesus points that out. He says, "Oh, you of little faith, why would you doubt God? He provides and cares for the birds. He provides and cares for the flowers. Trust him because he will provide and care for you too." So we've seen the introductory command. We've seen the arguments that follow. And then after presenting these arguments, Jesus concludes this teaching by returning to the command. Verse 29, he says, "Do not seek after what you will eat and drink." Don't pursue those things. Don't set your heart upon those things that are outside of your control. Don't occupy your mind with how to figure out what to eat. That's not your burden to carry. Do not worry. Again, a timeless, do not be worrying. And then he continues, "For all the nations of the world." Now, this is in contrast to those who are his disciples. All the nations of the world are not the children of God. These are those who are not in the faith, those who do not believe. These are the people who were spiritually dead, like you once were, the ones who are in their sin, like you once were, the ones who reject the truth, like you once did. Those people, Jesus says, those people do that. They seek after these things. That verb, seek, it appears three times in the final three verses of this text. That verb means to search diligently for, to strongly desire, to occupy all of oneself with. This is an intense verb indicating desperation and total focus. The world does that, Jesus says. Let them do it. That's the natural desire of the sinful heart because the world focuses on self. The world doesn't understand. But not you, my disciples, not you, O believer, he continues, "For your Father knows that you need them." Listen to those words again. Your Father knows that you need them. God is your Father. See, this is personal. It's indicative of a familial relationship of one who has been adopted into the family of God. And this is what happens when a dead sinner comes to life, when someone repents of their sin and trusts in Christ for salvation. One who was once a child of the world, a child of the devil, that person then becomes adopted into the family of God, into the royal family, to be a co-heir with Christ. When you repent of your sin and place your faith in Christ, God the Father becomes your Father. And your Father, he says, knows. He knows. He's omniscient, all-knowing, all-discerning. He knows what you need, and he knows what you need before you know that you need it. He knew that the coronavirus was coming. He knows what's going to happen next. He knows everything. He knows. So take comfort in that. But he knows, listen, he knows that you need them. He knows that you need them. Listen, Jesus is not trivializing food and clothing and the basic needs of life. It's easy to miss here. Okay, he's not dismissing those things. If I don't eat, I'm going to die. Husbands, fathers, if your wife and kids don't eat, they're going to die. This is serious. He's not trivializing this. He's not saying it's not important. He's saying he knows that you need these things. He knows that you must have them. Now, there's a difference. We need to point out there's a difference, right, between basic necessities and luxuries. He knows what you need, and oftentimes what we need is far more rudimentary than what we want, what we'd like to have, what we here in America have become accustomed to having, right? Like, do we need unlimited data and the newest iPhone? Do we need all those channels and all those flat screen TVs and the newest and the best and the most upgraded version of technology? Do we need the house and the car? Do we need all of the things that we've become accustomed to having? Things that are so ordinary in American culture? Of course not, but he does know what we do need. And the one who knows the need is the one who can supply it. Because the one who knows the need reigns in heaven, and he's good, and he's powerful, and he cares for his creation. And so Jesus says, do not worry. Do not worry. Do not be anxious and allow these things to control your every thought. But then I love how the passage concludes in verse 31. That word instead, in the ESV, instead of worrying. Don't just sit around. The command is not just to sit around and not worry. You know, the New Testament is full of these instead clauses. Many times people think Christianity is just a bunch of rules about things you can't do, right? So like, I wish I could do this thing, or I'm kind of inclined to do this thing, but I can't. And so I just have to sit on my hands and really hope that I don't, or try to distract myself so that I don't give in to that temptation. But in the New Testament, the reality is that there's not just commands to withdraw from some sinful activity, but there's always a positive command to pursue instead. Paul says in Ephesians 5, he says, do not be drunk with wine. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. In Ephesians 4, one chapter early, he says, let the thief no longer steal, but let him labor and work. And in this case, do not seek after these things, but instead diligently pursue and seek after his kingdom. Seek after the things of God. Trust God in all circumstances and pursue the fulfillment of his plan. Seek to grow in Christ and be more conformed to the image of the Son. Seek to glorify and worship God in all that you do. And in doing this, these other things will be added to you. As you seek after and trust in God, you can be sure that God will provide. Now, at this point, you might be saying to yourself, okay, that's great, Pastor. I think you're probably right for the most part. And it's there in the text. I'm not really going to argue with it. But let's not kid ourselves. Have you seen what's going on in the world? Like, do you know what's happening? Like, I know I shouldn't worry. I don't really want to worry, but I can't help it. Like, this is serious. This is scary. There's a lot of uncertainty. There's a lot of craziness happening. And perhaps you're worried because everyone else is worried, right? Like, you turn on the news and this is all anyone is talking about anywhere. You open up social media and the coronavirus dominates the headlines. You can't escape it. Maybe you're worried about someone getting it. Maybe you're worried about yourself getting it, about the pain and the severity and the discomfort that it might bring. Or maybe you're afraid that because of your immune system or your age or your current health situation, the consequences could be worse. Maybe you're worried that a loved one or someone you're close to might get it. Or maybe you're worried that the effects that this might have on the health of the children or the elderly. Maybe you're worried because you can't seem to get anything at the supermarket. What was once a simple trip to the store has turned into a several-hour ordeal filled with long lines and scant choices. Certain items are difficult to find. Hand sanitizer is completely off the shelves. And amazingly, toilet paper is the hottest commodity to have. It's the most sought-after item on the market. Maybe you're worried that things will never turn back to normal again. And you're worried about the long-term impact. Maybe you're worried about the financial markets, which have plummeted over the course of the past several days. Maybe you're a small business owner and you're worried about your current financial state and your financial state in the immediate and long-term future. Maybe you're worried that things will never go back to the way they were before. And if that's you, trust me, I get it. I empathize with you because those temptations are just as real for you as they are for me. But let us consider how we might apply the teaching of Jesus that we just examined to our current situation here today. Do not worry. Do not be anxious. Well, how do I think about that in the context of the coronavirus in 2020? Well, I want to give us 4 points of application to consider this morning. Number one, first of all, trust in God. That's my if you take nothing else away from me this morning, take that. Trust in God. Seek after his kingdom in such a way that you recognize that he is in control. And why can you trust God? Well, his providence sustains his creation in such a way that he feeds the birds of the air. He clothes the flowers of the field. And if he provides for birds and flowers, he's certainly going to provide for you. Now, the reality is, and I know this, that there are some folks who have died as a result of the virus. And most likely there are going to be more that die as well in the future. But we can trust God in knowing that he is not caught by surprise. This is all part of his ordained plan, and we know that his plan is ultimately for his good, for our good, excuse me, and for his glory. So trust in God during this time of chaos. Now, practically, how do I do that? Like, I want to, but how do I do it? Well, one of the ways that you build your trust in God is you fill your mind with the promises of God. Think about the passage of scripture we just examined. Jesus tells the disciples not to worry. And then he spends the rest of his argument talking about God. He talks about God and his goodness. The focus is not on you. The focus is on him. So saturate your mind with the words of scripture, which speak his praises and reflect on his goodness. Read books which examine the attributes of God. Listen to podcasts, read blogs and articles. Fill your mind with things that speak about the person and the works of God. And you know what that means, right? It means you need to turn off the news a little bit. Just get away, to unplug from all the craziness, unplug from that stuff that's coming in, which incites fear, and put your focus on the one who rules the world. Stop reading the doom and gloom articles. Focus on the things that are certain. Because listen, I don't know what's going to happen, but neither do they. And there's no point in filling your mind with these things that are uncertain. Instead, let me encourage you, fill your mind with the things that are sure, because no matter what happens, we know that God is on the throne. So first of all, trust in God. Secondly, humble yourself. Humble yourself. Hopefully you've realized in the craziness of this just how finite we are, just how fickle this whole world is, how easily and how fragile it is, how easily it can come crashing down because we are not in control. We so much have this illusion as a society and as individuals that we're in charge, but we're not. And we need to recognize that. 1 Peter 5 tells us to humble ourselves, and in so doing, by recognizing that we can't actually handle all of the weightiness of what's happening around us, when we recognize that we are not responsible for that, we are not in control of that, then we are able to cast our anxieties on him because we admit and acknowledge that God is the one who is on the throne. Now, I'm not saying, please don't hear me say this. I'm not saying that you don't have any responsibility. Because listen, if you don't have any food in your house and you think that God's just going to pour down manna from heaven, you might be in trouble. Like I'm just saying you need to be prepared. The book of Proverbs talks about the wisdom and being ready, have preparations made. I'm not ignoring that. I'm simply speaking of the mindset that comes with one who has humbled himself versus the one who believes that he is in control. You know, there's a difference between going to the supermarket and getting some food and supplies and necessary items to have on hand just in case things take a turn for the worse, and they very well could. There's a difference between doing that and panicking to the point where you have no grip on reality and you're scrambling each and every moment of the day, fretting and worried about what might happen every 5 minutes. Just go down to Walmart sometime this afternoon and you can tell the difference between those two people really quickly. That's the way of the world. The world is going to seek after those things because the world doesn't trust God, but we do. And because we trust God, we humble ourselves in recognition that we are not in control. So first, trust God. Second, humble yourself. Third, pray that God's will would be done. And we don't pray to God out of panic and desperation, pleading with him to keep the world from flailing around like it seems to be doing. See, we don't know what God is up to, but our prayer is that his will would be done. And what happens when we pray for God's will to be done is that our hearts and minds become focused on him and on his plans. And when we focus on God and on his plans, we are less concerned with ourselves and our plans. And when we're less concerned with ourselves and our plans, we're less inclined to worry. So prayer aligns our hearts and minds with the will of God so that we are less concerned about ourselves and more concerned with him. First, trust in God. Second, humble yourself. Third, pray for God's will to be done. And fourth and finally, remember that the temptation to worry is temporary. The temptation to worry is temporary because in heaven, there will be no worry. There will be no need to worry. Every tear will be wiped away. Every concern will be gone. The coronavirus will not be in existence. There will not be empty supermarket shelves. There will not be any concern. There's not going to be any media pouring fret and panic into our lives. That's all going to be gone. And we're going to be able to worship unhindered by the cares of any kind to give glory to the one to whom all glory is due. So let us not be a people defined by our worry. Instead, let us seek the kingdom of God, for he is on his throne now and forevermore. I'm going to close this in a time of prayer. When I'm done praying, I want us to sing a song in response. Maybe you're really concerned. Maybe this whole situation knocked out of your routine. Maybe it's got you worried. I'm praying for you as a church family. I'm praying that you would recognize and trust in the goodness of God and the words that we have just examined. But if you want to talk to somebody, if you just need some reassurance, maybe you don't know what it's like to be one of those who are in Christ. And you think, I want that knowledge. I want that hope. I want that trust. I just don't have it. Please reach out to us. Some mechanism, whether it's email or a phone call or a Facebook message, we'll get in touch with you. Just reach out to us and let us know how we can connect with you, because I want you to know there's no need to worry. There's no justification for worry because God is ultimately on his throne. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for this word. We thank you for the promise, for the goodness. God, I thank you even that it's a command, not a suggestion, because I need to know with certainty that I have no need to worry. I have no grounds for worry. I need not be anxious because I know that you care for your creation. You care for the birds of the air, for the flowers of the field. God, you're going to provide for us too. What that looks like, God, we don't know. We don't know what you're up to, but we trust you and we take great comfort in that. And there's great reassurance in knowing that you are indeed on the throne. God, I pray for those listening right now and later on, if there's anyone who doesn't know that truth, who doesn't have that hope, God, I pray that your spirit might move in such a way that they are convicted and compelled to come to you to give their lives to Christ. And I pray now as we sing in response that you might allow us to be a light into this world, to show that hope and that confidence that we have in you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we sing the song of response, may you hear this first verse as a prayer of petition, asking God to provide, to shelter, to comfort, and the second verse as a plea to ourselves to respond in faith.
Hide me now. In Christ alone.
Hear this word from Scripture as we end our time together today. This is from Matthew 6, verses 33 and 34. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Find rest in Christ alone. Thank you for worshiping with us today. May you be blessed.